All right, hell yeah. We got material mechanics, and we got a tricky problem, but we should be able to rock it out. This has to deal with elastoplastic, you know what I mean? Everything in material mechanics just makes it sound confusing and really difficult. It doesn't have to be. So this is one of those videos where we can do kind of a cool trick. The first kind of two rules of material mechanics is that, hey, you know, we have this thing called strength, and you should just remember this one for steel, 58,000 PSI. And I'm going to take a little tangent right now because I made a mistake because I said E for steel was 29 million. So I said it was 19 million. But how are you going to remember these numbers? You know what I mean? It's because, and then in metric, the strength of steel in metric is 200 megapascals. And then the E, the modulus of elasticity, and this is just a constant that relates, you know, the change in length, because that's the second, you know, two fundamentals of material mechanics are one is that force over area is strength, you know what I mean? And then the second is change in length divided by the total length. You know, you could kind of do this as percent change in length, you know what I mean? But get rid of the 100%, and this is called strain. You know what I mean? So this is strength, and this is stretch. You know, I call it stretch because that's just a normal sounding word. Strain and epsilon. You know what I mean? That's just it's a whole nother world of crazy. You know what I mean? It's just too confusing just for the average person to pick up if they just want to pick up some of these little. You know what I mean? Anyway. And so how do you remember that the modulus of elasticity for steel is, this is 400 gigapascals. So even just right here, it's a total identical divide by 2. Take 400, divide by 2, you get 200. Well, guess what? You know what I mean? It took me a couple years to figure this out, but you take 58, divide that by 2, you get 29. You know what I mean? So it's exactly the same. So if you can remember, because I think people can remember, hey, the strength of steel, 200 megapascals, this comes up quite a bit. You know what I mean? Quite a bit. And then I just keep drilling in that the strength of steel is 58,000. It's a good one because it's in the textbooks. It's the yield strength of steel, and that's kind of what we're going to be talking about. All right, so that wasn't too much of an aside. And again, stretch, change in length divided by total length. Heck yeah, we call that stretch. We call it strain, and then is this epsilon. It's a unitless term, and cool. So at the end of the day, if I say that steel has a strength of 58,000 PSI or a strength of 200 megapascals, which is just 10 to the 6th, newtons per meter squared. That's a pascal. One pascal is just one newton divided by meter squared. We've made videos on this. You know, it's basically it's the weight of two newspapers over an area of one square meter. It's not very much pressure. That's why these numbers are huge. Okay, so now, so we're just going to say, hey, well, let's just say we have one of these bars. So we have five bars. They each have a diameter of 10 millimeters. So, heck, we're going to be in metric, so we're going to not use the 58,000, not use the 29,000. Let's throw up the other equation. So anytime you get a material mechanics problem, you're going to write, heck, yeah, strength is force divided by area. Then, sure, you should, because it's the second rule of material mechanics, things are going to fail two ways. One, if they reach... You know what I mean? Their strength, if you have a force over an area that's more than this, well, you got breakage. Okay? And then you have this other aspect of material mechanics that, hey, things do elastically stretch. They're really stiff springs. It's really cool. If you knew a lot about springs and like spring problems, no one does, it would be more intuitive to be like, oh, these are just stiff springs. But anyway, so they are going to change in length. And they can only change in length so far, you know what I mean? So for steel, the change in length over the total length or the strain is 0.002. So 0.2% of the total length, that's it. That is all you can stretch it before bad things happen. Either it breaks or it just... that's where we get into this plastically stretches, you know what I mean? So plastic. All right, so, and that's going to happen for steel at this number, 0.002. So we should write that in. 0.002. Just like strength is a max, you know what I mean? This would be your max strength. Sometimes I do this. That's very helpful. This is also a max, max strain. It's the max change in length you can get if you have a given length. So if I say, hey, if I have a given length right here and it's made out of steel, I can only change its length by this 0.002 times the total length. Just rearrange the equation. Yep, because just saying the word strain every time, get used to it, but it's I swear every time you say the word strain, you're just like, now I'm just doubly confused. But heck yeah, strain, stretch, if you call it stretch, heck yeah, it's just the relationship between the, you're stretching it out, but you're stretching it out as a proportion, you know, of the total length. You know what I mean? So it's the percent stretch. It's the fractional stretch. That's strain. That stretch. Okay. So right off the bat, if you're given a material that has a, and this has a yield of 250. So maybe it's made out of something that's a little bit stronger than steel. So we're gonna go with that. We're gonna go with we're gonna go with the fact that it's 250. I was just gonna pretend that it's steel. But that's fine. We'll go with this, but we're still going to say it has a modulus of elasticity of 400 gigapascals. And we should talk about that. I guess this video is not going to be, super long, because I always use these to do a tutorial. You know, if you've never done these problems before, it's like, these are the basics that you just have to know going into every problem. All right. So, there you go. You got change in length. That's the other aspect. You got the... So if I'm just given this material right off the bat, I can be like, okay, I know the strength is 250 megapascals, and I want to find the total load I can put on one of these bars. So I'm going to go force, rearrange this equation, is the strength times the area. See how I bring the A upstairs? And heck yeah. And then that's just 250 times 10 to the 6 newtons per meter squared, and then I just multiply it by the area, which is the area of one of these is just pi over 4 times the diameter. It's 10 millimeters. So you either have to divide this by 1,000 now and turn this into 123.01 meters. That might be helpful. And then square it, because these units, if this is square, if the area is meter squared, it's got to meter squared, it has to cancel those meters. You get newtons. Okay, heck yeah. So we're going to get a force of 250 times, and if you see this, I mean the skilled way to do this is just be like, heck yeah, 250 times 10 to the 6 times pi divided by 4 times 10 squared, but then if you square millimeters, you have to divide by 10 to the 6. These 10 to the 6s cancel, and heck yeah, that's the fast way, 250. So now we just got 250 times this 100 times pi, and then divide by 4. Cool. Then I'm going to store this in my calculator as p. So each one of these can only take a load, p, of 19,634.9, we'll just round it off, newtons. So there you go, 19,635 newtons. And if you get any more than that, then, you know what I mean, I just say, hey, breakage, you know what I mean, is either going to break, you're going to lose your job, and people are going to lose your lives. At the end of the day, you want to build stuff where you're not taking things, that this whole problem deals with taking things kind of past their limit, you know what I mean? And you wouldn't want to design anything like that. But actually, you know what I mean, if you take a step back, some things like this, because this is a determinate structure, if you welded this together, there is no possible way that these are all going to, you know, you might have a minuscule, you might have little gaps in this, gaps in that, gaps in that, gaps in, and then no gaps in this. And then you might have designed this to where, hey, this one of them can't take the load. You know what I mean? That's why you have 5. If you just had 1, you'd just do 1. But when you put this thing together, you know, this is all welded. And then when you put this together, heck, there's gaps in this. So you're actually going to pull down on this. All right, more time on the clock. All right, heck yeah. So again, you're going to pull down on this one, and this one can't take the load. You know what I mean? So it's actually going to plastically stretch. And your gap, I mean, because things can only stretch so far. If you have 1 meter, 0.002 of 1 meter is 2 millimeters. So let's say your gap is more than 2 millimeters, and this is a 1 meter bar. Well, you've already... or let's say, yeah, these gaps over here are more than 2 millimeters, and then this just got really tight. And then when you put the load on, well, now you're stretching this one out more than 2 millimeters, and so you've already, you know what I mean, done the X on this. You already said, hey, well, we're into breakage perspective, or like, hey, people are going to lose their lives, lose their jobs. But so here's the huge, like, hey. That's why we do these problems that are more complex with be like, oh, well, this is actually what happens in real life, and it's okay. And the reason being is because, let's look at this. If I have a 1 meter steel bar, and I can only change its length by like 2 millimeters, it's such a small, it's like hardly registerable by the eye. But guess what? If I take this same 1 meter bar, and, you know, put it in a machine that's actually going to stretch it out, I could stretch it up to 30% of its length. You know what I mean? So we take 1,000 times 30.3. So this thing could stretch all the way to another 300 millimeters. So if it's 1,000 millimeters or 1 meter, I could get 1.3 meters out of a slice of steel, and then it's going to break. You know what I mean? So that is what I'm getting at here is that's you can stretch steel a huge amount, and it still holds so the graph is like, hey, yeah, if you can get up to 58,000, but yeah, once you get up to that point, then steel starts to stretch, but it still can take a 58,000 load. So then you have this. You have the strength or the stress, which is in PSI, on that axis. And then you have your strain. This is your change in length divided by the total length. This is force divided by area. If you already chose a specimen like this, hey, you already chose the area. That's a given. And then you already chose the length. So what you really do have here, even though it is a stress-strain relationship, what you do have a relationship, you do definitely have a very proportional relationship between the force you're putting in and then your change in length. You know what I mean? So that's where anytime you see a stress-strain diagram, well, heck, pop out the equation for force over area, change in length over area, and then circle those because those are your constants. You already designed it. And now you're putting the forces, and then you're observing change in length. So that's why it's linear for the linear range, and then you have the yield strength. And then for these elastoplastic, in real life, it kind of does this and then breaks. But for these elastoplastic problems, we just say, hey, let's just do a straight line. It's conservative. Even though you can get a little bit more force out of it, we're just going to say as a conservative perspective, it's just going to look like that. So this force is still at 58,000 pounds, and now we have just a kind of a constant change in length. You know, but it's going to break. I mean, so if you just had one of these bars, and then you put 58,000 pounds on it, like what you would see is like, okay, it would start to stretch, and if you keep applying that 58,000, well, it's gonna stretch to here and then break. You know what I mean? But in this case, this middle bar is going to stretch, but then is going to be captured by the other bars. You know what I mean? So this one will be plastic, but maybe these ones won't be. These are still in their linear elastic range. So once the gaps got filled up, then heck yeah. Don't have that same load on them. All right, so now we are going to we're gonna do the first trick of this problem. So let's grab a sheet of paper. So we have this idea of taking something to its plastic limit. At the plastic, it doesn't mean that it loses any of its strength. its strength is that max. And so we've already determined that. We said, heck yeah, our strength equation is force over area. Our strain is change in length over total length. And I apologize. I should have wrote the relationship between these two, because now the other equation is strength is equal to EE. This is probably the easiest way to remember it. But just know that this is a huge number. This is a tiny number. And then you get kind of like a normal number in between. There's a lot of different ways to get this relationship. Let's say you just took E, which is a huge number, and then let's divide it by the normal number. So now you're just dividing it by a normal number. Well, big divided by a normal number, that's going to give you holy Toledo. No, that would be a bad way to do it. Oh, yeah, so I guess this gives you 1 divided by... Yeah, I apologize. I always thought this was 100% accurate, where you just take these numbers and range them. But nah, that way it doesn't work. If you take the normal number of strength and divide it by the huge number of E, then heck yeah, a normal number divided by a big number gives you a smaller number, and that will be E. I'm glad I actually came across one scenario where that just common relationship won't work. But there you go. So here's your 3 equations. And cool. And we've already rearranged this one for the max force is the strength times the area. We're going to say the strength is this yield strength. And we already did that. And we got 19,635 newtons. This is our stored in our calculator as P. So we're just going to call that P. I guess there's a lot of P's going on. I'll still keep that as F. But it's in our calculator as stored as the letter P. All right, so I guess the trick on this is that let's say all of these... So all these bars are the same, and they can take this much load. So cool, let's say this one has that same load. Let's say they all have that same load of P. Once they reach that, what's going to happen to this point? This point is permanently just going to stretch out until it breaks. And like I said, it could stretch like 30%, you know what I mean? So we can't have all these bars. Once all these bars get to their plastic limit, then the whole thing is just going to start to stretch and break. You know what I mean? But you can take it up to that. So what they say is like, well, how much load can you get before... Like, you know, it's a statics problem up to that point. You know what I mean? Just this, like if one of these bars or two of these bars have just slightly under that load, you know what I mean? The thing will be a statics problem. It won't be moving. It'll be just permanently static. But the second you get more than that plastic load, now you got stretch till breakage. All right. But I think that's enough preamble to show you that each of these bars can see this load. So if each of these bars do see that load, then we can easily find P. So we're going to say, hey, P is acting at this point, and then we have this bar, this, and then these two, and then those two. And they're all going to be, let's get this letter as F, store it as alpha F, because this is going to be our letter P. So heck yeah, so all these are just F, you know what I mean? So we pulled down on this, and then we're just stretching all the bars until they're all F. Like, we don't have to know anything about which one's going to become maxed out first. You know what I mean? But I think we already showed visually that if we had gaps on these ends, this first bar could get maxed out first. I think I don't know if that's intuitive, because you could also say that you could have a gap here and then these other bars settle in. But this first bar is the shortest. So we also have this relationship, so when you put these together, when you say that strength is force over area and stretch is change in length over total length, and it has a relationship with this a modulus of elasticity, then we can say that the relationship is this. We're gonna throw those equations in. Force over area is equal to change in length. Alright, I don't know if it cut out, but we're taking these three equations and then putting them together. So definitely we want to relate kind of force and change in length. So we take the stress and strain, put them here. We take force over area, put it in for this value. Change in length over total length, put it in for the strain value. And now we have an equation that relates all of these five different kind of parameters. This is a constant, but like what I was trying to get at was change in length is equal to FL over EA. You see this a lot. And this is like the max change in length that you can get. We could say this is max change in length if the force is max and the area is given, the material is given, and the length is, you know what I mean? The length is given. And so there you go. So the change in length, and you got to think also, change in length is a matter of, hey, you can only change something's length so far before it's going to break. You know what I mean? That was the kind of the two rules of Fight Club, two rules of material mechanics. You can take something up to its max stress, which is PSI, which is force over area. I call it strength. So you can take it up to that number, or you can, you know, take it up to the max strain, which is change in length over total length. So this change in length can only be so much, and given just a standard length L, it's that. If these are longer, then the change in length max for the other bars would be like F, and then some sort of, you know what I mean, it might be 2L, or, you know what I mean, over EA. So those bars can change their length longer, so that's one way to show that this bar will hit this max force first, and then these other bars will, and I might have said that totally wrong. But no, I don't think so, because there is another element here also, is that I don't think I said that one wrong. So that is one parameter of this setup. So we're also going to look at another one. We're going to take it to the extreme. Let's say we just have three bars. One is real short, and then the others are coming at really long angles like this, and then they're all rigidly supported. And then we put a load here. Like 10, you know what I mean? These could see 100, and then this bar is just going to see like 10, you know what I mean? Or you know what I mean? If this was like 30, you know, this is going to capture a third. These bars are going to capture a third of the weight. But in this case, these ones are actually going to go to max a lot faster. So there is that aspect. So these bars are going to get the max, going to get maxed out first because of the geometry. They are longer though, so they can stretch out farther. So if, that goes back to what all these problems are. Kind of welded units, you know what I mean? We're not talking about pin connections. Like, yeah, sure, if this was a pin connection, holy Toledo, like these are going to max out first. But if it's not a pin connection and it's just a welded unit, well, these are hardly going to help out at all. And this middle section is going to lengthen. And the second this middle section lengthens, these like really haven't felt anything. I was trying to make this problem easier, but I think what I said there is pretty accurate, but I would have to you know, maybe do a diagram. But anyway, so the easiest way to do these elastoplastic problems are just like, okay, well, if all the members can get up to the same F, well, now we can just solve it. We can actually find the max load. That's all it was asking for. Just based on this free body diagram and the angles of these. So we're gonna do that. We're gonna sum the forces in the y direction is equal to zero. And I was gonna do some more problems, but no, let's just focus on one at a time, get through this, and call it a video. So I'm going to do the trick of like, well, how do you find, because this force is in the y direction. And so so our forces in the y direction are going to be P is negative, but I'm just going to say that's equal. You know, you could do negative P plus and then all those forces. But and then that's equal to zero. I'm just going to take the P to the other side and then kind of flip it around. That's why I just do P. The force balance is like, hey, this force is going to be balanced by all those forces. So heck yeah. So we got P is equal to, you know, hey, this F, there you go. So just that F, and then plus, well, now it's this F, but only the vertical component. So we have to take this and find the vertical component. So from statics class, you do a lot of these problems just based on geometry. Sometimes it is nice to have an angle. If I knew this angle, I would say, hey, the sun is shining. This is the sine component. And that means the adjacent component is the cosine component. This is obviously the hypotenuse. And we're talking about this member right here. So the force in this member, like what component is actually in the vertical direction? Well, sun is shining on this angle. It's the cosine of this angle. But yeah, yeah. So I maybe I don't know the cosine of that angle. You know what I mean? But I do know the one thing that you should always have in your back pocket is a unit vector. So you can always say, hey, see how this length is 2b? Well, let's just say I knew this, the hypotenuse here. I'm just gonna say it's a fraction between this height 2b divided by this length. And that is the fractional component in the vertical direction. So I'm just gonna say, hey, that's 2b divided by, and now I need this length, and the hypotenuse is just a squared plus b squared square root of that. So I just go straight to my square root, and I go, I'm just going to say, hey, this is my a squared. I'm going to go b squared plus 2b squared, and then the square root of that. And then this is going to be multiplied by the force. So that there you go. And check it out. There's two of them. So you can always do parentheses 2. Just don't forget about that. And know that this fractional component right here is a fraction between 0 to 1. You know what I mean? Because only, like, look at this. You can just see that, hey, most of it, this is at a 45. So 70%, if you said this was a 10, that this is about 7. So if I do like, hey, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, this is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. You know what I mean? So at a 45 degree angle, it's 70%. But in a steeper angle, like these are almost identical. If this is 10, this is about 9. You know what I mean? It's 8.66. But in this case, it's not a 30 degree. It's not exactly 30 degrees. So there you go. So we did that one, and then plus we'll do that same thing again. So we're going to figure out the component. So the vertical component of this one is 2b divided by the square root, and the hypotenuse is going to be 2b squared plus 2b squared. And that's going to be that f, and there's two of those. Okay, so now let's simplify this. So we can go, this is just f plus, this is going to be 4 divided by, hey, this squared goes to 4 squared. So do you see this? This is just 1b squared plus 4b squared, and then you get 5b squared. You're going to take the square root of that, which is the same thing as taking the square root of 5 and then the square root of b squared. You know what I mean? And then you get the square root of 5 times b, and then you got 4b on top, so you're going to get 4b divided by the square root of 5b. The b's cancel, and there you go. You just got 4 divided by the square root of 5. And that was the ratio there, and now you're going to get this one. This is going to be 8, square root of 8, and then 4 on top. So you're going to get 4 divided by the square root of 8. The b's cancel, force. And booyah. And so now you're just going to get equal to f is 1 plus 4 divided by the square root of 5 plus 4 divided by the square root of 8. And if you do this into your calculator, and yeah, we already doubled them. So these are now not, these are numbers greater than 1. All right, heck yeah, home stretch. These are numbers greater than 1 because we already doubled them. You know what I mean? If you divided both these by 2, this one comes out to be 0.707, and this one comes out to be 0.89. You know what I mean? 899. 0.866 is a 30 degree angle, and so this angle is a little bit less. And so we'll probably do it one more way, but let's just finish it out and then do it one more way. So then this F is, we already stored in our calculator as 19.635 newtons. But let's add these up just so you can see what multiple, you know, of F is this load. Oh, and then before we do that, you know, if you just took this problem and said, hey, let's say all the bars are vertical. You know what I mean? That would be the simplest. And how much load can you get out of them? Well, one bar you can get 19,000. So just take that alpha F times 5. And then so we should expect a 98,174 newton load. We'll see what we get here. So heck yeah. So we get 1 plus 4 divided by the square root of 5 plus 4 divided by the square root of 8. And then, so this comes to be a multiple of 4.2. Look at this. This was a 5 multiple. If we had them vertical, that was the simple. We should have done that just right off the bat. But, you know, doing these videos, I can only teach so much at once. And I think people just watch these videos because they're a little bit crazy. Anyway, all right, so we take that and then multiply by F. And we get the max load is 82,527 newtons. Okay, and I'm glad I did that because now you have a check on reality that, yeah, it's because of the angles, you know, you can put less, and that's what that is. Now, let's might as well just make a long video. You know what I mean? We're going to do this one more time of saying, what's another way? Because sometimes people like angles, and here's a way to just do it real fast. You can say the sum of the forces in the y direction is 0. So you can say, hey, P is equal to, well, I know it's got to be equal to, and we're going to say these are Fs, and then this is a P down. So we're going to say, hey, this is equal to one of these. The vertical one's totally vertical. And then plus, how about this one? Well, we're going to say it's F. But then if this is the angle sun is shining, this is the sine, and so it's cosine. So we're going to say cosine, because that's the adjacent component of that, cosine of the angle. Now, I don't know the angle, but I do know inverse tangent. You should always know that, hey, if I have an angle here and I know the A side and the B side of a hypotenuse, you know, triangle, if I know the right, if I don't know the hypotenuse, but I know the two other sides, heck yeah, I can just say tangent, inverse tangent is B divided by 2B, because the tangent of an angle is the opposite over the adjacent. So if I took the tangent of this angle, I'm going to get opposite B divided by 2B. And the inverse tan, or the arctan, I'm not going to say it arctan, I'm just going to say it inverse tangent. I think we all know what the hell's going on. But heck yeah, this angle is inverse tangent of that opposite over adjacent. You know what I mean? So you can just do this all in one go, be like, heck yeah, I know this is the cosine component of this force, because it's the if the sun is shining, this must be the sine, but this is the cosine component of this angle. Angle is the tangent of B divided by 2B, which is just one half. There you go. Inverse tangent of a half, and then that's it. And then, but we then multiply by 2, because we got 2 of those. On to the next one, plus F, cosine, and then we have inverse tangent of 2 divided by 2. So that's just going to be inverse tangent of 1. So let's do that in our calculator. We're going to go alpha F, so we're going to go alpha F plus alpha F cosine, and then we're going to go inverse tangent of 1 half. I guess I'll just do it 1 over 2, just visually, looks nicer. And then plus alpha F cosine of inverse tangent of 1. And, for the love of God, because I forgot the 2s. You know what I mean? You got to multiply that by 2. So let's go back and then throw those 2s in there. because that was just for one of these forces. Obviously, we have symmetry on both sides, so if I find the vertical component of this force, just multiply it by 2, and that's what I did not do. Booyah! We got our answer. 82,527 pounds. Okay, so now the question does not ask this, but we're gonna go over it because it should. It should be a one-star problem just to get two things out of the way at the same time. The question is, how much change in length would you have right here? We're gonna call this point C. What is the change in length of point C? And how would you solve that? You know what I mean? I swear, just saying this is elastoplastic kind of just makes your mind melt as well, as the steel melts and stretches plastically. But, how would you do that? What is that point? And let's go back to this, because if all of these reach this plastic force, yes, then they're just going to stretch until they break. You know what I mean? And that stretch, again, is like 30%. Things can stretch up to 30%. Sometimes steel only stretches 5% and then it breaks. But it can stretch up to 30% of its length. But we know that once all the material goes plastic, we know that if we have any individual bar, the change in length is just minuscule. It's so tiny that once that happens, it starts that plastic stretch. But that happens at such a small change in length that we're saying this change in length has to be real small, and then it's going to start to stretch out and then do that. All right. So, but now what we this might be a harder problem. Let's see. I'm going to take a little break. All right, heck yeah. Yeah, no, this is a little bit of a harder problem, especially with the geometry. So let's go to a two-star problem that is actually easier. You know what I mean? And because that's what I wanted to do. I wanted to show, like, hey, this was real easy. We can at least find the forces. Change in length is kind of a geometry problem at that point. But hey, let's take a look at this one. Even though it's two-star, this is one of the easiest two-star problems now that we have this idea that once the material goes plastic, it's load. So heck yeah. So we have the strength is force over area. So check out this problem. Is like, hey, we're gonna stress so we have a shell, and then we're gonna stress that. And the second, let's say the middle part is just gone. You know what I mean? But we want to know the max force we can put on this. Well, you have an area here, and then you have a strength. Yield strength, and that's kind of your max strength. So the max force is going to be your yield strength, or your max strength, times your area. And once we find that, that's the force where, sure, the point that's going to happen is a very small change in length. And in this problem, that change in length is going to be like right about there. It's going to close the gap and then some. But literally, that change in length is so small that once you reach it, heck yeah, then you're just going to squash the thing, like to a 30% reduction, but you're still going to hold this max force. So let's do that real fast. And then we have, we're in American units. So we have this at the strength, and it looks like these are not steel. No, it is. Well, yeah, there's the modulus of elasticity of steel. Oh, they're not using 58,000, but they're just using a lower value in 36. Yeah, that's totally representative of steel. So we're going to do 36,000 pounds, and then an area of pi divided by 4. This is going to be outside diameter 3 inches squared minus inside diameter 2.5 inches squared. And let's do that. So we got 36,000 times pi divided by 4 times 3 squared minus 2.7 squared. All right, so we have a force. We're going to store that as alpha F of 40,644 pounds. So that's the max force that you can see in here. And then, so there you go. We already determined the yield load of the tube. That's question A. It's like check mark. We already know that. You know what I mean? And then it says determine the plastic load P of the tube. Determine the plastic load P P of the tube. Well, I guess what they're saying is, like, how much load would this be before the tube goes plastic? Well, don't answer that question. Just take the tube itself and do the same thing. Let's say we have this tube and we're just going to, you know, put a force on the tube. So we're going to do the same thing. We're going to say max force on that tube is the strength times the area, which is 36,000 times pi divided by 4. This tube has a diameter of 1.5 squared. So let's do that, 36,000 times pi divided by 4 times 1.5 squared. And we get 63,000, because the area is much, this area is much larger than that area. That area is kind of thin, this area is kind of big. Okay, there you go. And that's how many pounds of force we can get on this tube. Okay, so now, just in general, this problem would be more advanced if you had to do it two different ways, where, like, once this material, but these materials are the same. You know what I mean? So this isn't a three-star problem. You know what I mean? These materials are the same. This has a lower area. It can take a lower force. But anyway, let's not get too confused. So the max force in the tube is 63,000. The max force in the shell is 40,000. And then if you look at steel as a spring, so like this is a spring, and then the inside is a spring. So this spring can take 40,000 pounds, and once it does, it's pushing back with 40,000. You know what I mean? You're pushing one way with 40,000 for sure. That's the plastic load. But it is actually pushing back. It wants to spring back, basically. So to get this, to get to 63,000, you have to push back on this 40,000. You have to push back on this 40,000 to neutralize that 40, and then plus the 63. So the plastic load of the tube is just both these numbers added. We're going to store that as alpha G. This is G, this is F. And alpha F plus alpha G. So then you get 104,261 pounds. So that's the answer in the back of the book. Heck yeah. Now, I guess this problem, which we should probably do, says, so yeah, that was question B. Now it says construct a load. Well, no, that was it. Oh, no. And determining the shortening of the tube. You know what I mean? So I guess those are different questions. Because one, so let's do this, because and then we might go back and kind of do a longer video. So let's say we just have the shell. The shell is going to, and we have our equations. We have strength is force over area, strain is change in length over total length, and E is, this strength is in a relationship between strain and modulus of elasticity. And if we put all these together, a quick one to do is just is FL over EA. This is one that you put all three of these together, you get this. You know, that's going to be your standard bread and butter. So the change in length for this shell, just the shell itself, is going to take that, well, is going to take that max load F of 40,000. The length is 15 inches. And then the E is 29 times 10 to the 6. Because this is 29 times 10 to the 3 KSI, 1,000 pounds per square inch. So PSI is 29 times 10 to the 6, 29 million. The area is 3 squared minus 2.75 squared, because it's the diameters. And then we can find that change in length. And so if you do that, we're going to go alpha F times 15 divided by 29 times 10 to the 6. Divided by pi divided by 4 divided by 3 squared minus 2.75 squared. All right, and we get a change in length of 0.0186. So if we just had the shell alone, the shell can change its length by 0.0186. And that's king. No matter what forces are on the shell, it can only change its length. So it doesn't matter if you have a chunk of steel and you have, like, let's say, tensile forces this way, So you have like a tensile forces this way, and then you have like a load P on here. Well, now that's going to get into something else. But yeah, because that you would have to take half this, and then this change in length would be representative of half the length. You know what I mean? And then, but anyway, so this shell can only change its length by that much. What's going to happen is this clearance is only 0.01 inches, and then the change in length can be 0.0186. So we're going to store that as X, and then or actually store that as alpha D, and then we're going to go minus 0.01, stored as alpha X. All right, store that as X. And so for this problem, determine that in the corresponding short. Determine the yield load. Determine the yield and the corresponding shortening of the tube. Determine the plastic load and the corresponding shortening of the tube. Oh, okay. So, that's interesting. Okay, so, I guess what they're saying is like, hey, when this gets to its final change in length and the shell goes plastic, it's going to be 0.0186, and then the tube will shorten by it. Well, you got to close the gap, and then so the tube will shorten by this 0.0086. You know what I mean? So that'll be the shortening of the tube. But then if you hit the plastic load of the tube itself, what's going to be the shortening of the tube? We're going to go over that one. All right, heck yeah. So we're back, and so just a little clarification. So the shell can only change its length by this formula. You know what I mean? That's it. You know, with the max force, it can change its length by 0.186. So they're saying this tube is going to be that long. So the shortening of the tube in the back of the book is 0.186. Now, I thought they were saying, hey, this inner thing, that's what they were calling the tube. But no, the whole thing is kind of the tube in general. So now the question is, if you hit this if you hit the plastic load, all you're doing is having a max force. Once that force goes max, you can just take this out of the equation and... but it's like a heavy spring. It's going the other direction. You have a force max resisting. So now you would take this tube and be like, whoa, you have this force max resisting, and now you have to apply a load P. Well, these cancel, and then the additional force greater than that's what's going to be starting to compress this. So I guess the question is, what is the change in length of the tube once this starts to go plastic? So we've already, you can do that as a separate problem. This tube is going to go plastic once you hit 63,000 pounds on the tube. You know what I mean? Or that PSI. I like to think of it as, pounds on the tube. So if you just had the force on the tube is 63, if you had the tube alone, that's the force that's going to cause plastic motion. So now you do the same equation. Change in length of the tube is this force, G, L of the tube is 1 minus, it's 15 inches minus this gap. I mean, if you're getting real technical, which these problems are, that's the length of the tube. It's just a little bit smaller than 15 inches. But now we're going to divide that by E, which is 29 million times 10 to the 6. And then your A is pi divided by 2, 1.5 squared. And heck yeah, we'll get the change in length for that. So it's alpha G, 15 minus 0.01, divided by 29 times 10 to the 6, divided by pi divided by 4, divided by 1.5 squared. Heck yeah, and you get a change in length of that as 0.0. Oh, I swear we just did that one. alpha G. Yeah, 63. Okay, so this tube can change in length by 0.0186. That's wild. Did they set up the problem where both can change in length the same amount? That's interesting. Yeah, let's go back to the... I'm curious. Let's do this one. So this would be alpha F, which is at 40 times 15, divided by 29 times 10 to the 10 to the 6. Divided by pi divided by 4, divided by 3 squared minus 2.75 squared. Yeah, those are the same numbers. They're slightly different. But yeah, that makes that problem holy hell confusing. But yeah, you're almost getting the same numbers for both those. So this is stored as alpha D. But this one we're gonna store as alpha E. But yeah, that's confusing in its own right. But yeah, this change in length right there is enough from this 15 to 15 minus 0.01. Even though the areas are different, man, they set this up just to be visually or just calculatively confusing, just because you get the same change in length there. But okay, so there you go. Can get some more time. All right, heck yeah. So the end of the day, the tube can change in length by that much. So if it can change in length by this alpha E, the total length of the tube would be closing this gap 0.1, so we're gonna say plus 0.01, and then the total change in length would be 0.0286, and holy hell, we'll see the answers in the back of the book. 212.11, you're gonna get 0.0286. There you go, and then this other one was 0.01862, and. But yeah, I'm sure that was a little bit confusing. But at the end of the day, once something reaches its plastic range, it's just a constant force kind of in the opposite direction. So I thought that kind of made this problem easier. Now we are going to go back. I think we're going to go back to this problem. Let's see if we could figure out. Let's use our change in length equation. Change in length is FL over EA, and the max force in each of these has to be the same. So the change in length of this one, let's just say we say this is L, or no, it's 2B. There you go, over EA. And this is F. So the change in length is force in this one times 2B over EA. Now the change in length in this one is force over this one. What was it? The square root of 5? Square root of 5B, because that's going to be more than 2. It's going to be 2.12 or something. Square root of 5, 2.23 divided by EA. So this one can change in length more. So yeah, that just shows right there that this one's going to become plastic first, and then this one can change in length more, and then the final out here, this one's going to be force square root of 8b divided by EA. So that's going to be the max change in length. Once we reach this change in length on these outside tubes, then you're starting to get into that plastic range. You're going to go plastic. So now we need to figure out what this distance is. That's what I want to do. I thought that would make this kind of at least a one-star problem. And then so geometry. So initially, you're going to have this. You're going to have this is 2b. This is square root of 8b. Now final, you're going to have this plus a change in... this is going to stretch out. So you're going to have... you're going to have the square root of 8b plus the change in length. And the change in length will be the force square root of 8b over EA. And then this will be, we won't know this, so this will be height final. And then, but we do know that this will not change. This will just be 2b. So then we can say that this delta C is equal to the height final minus the height initial. Height initial is 2b, so it's height final minus 2b. And so using Pythagoreans, if this is a, this is b, and this is c squared, we're going to find this height final by taking this squared minus this. So, well, let's just grab fresh sheets of paper. Trying to find better ways to do this. All right, heck yeah. So let's do this. So let's do it all in this form where you can change f to be anything. Okay, so we're gonna say square root. Well, what is that? Square root of 8. Yeah, this one is square root of 8. So we got square root of 8b plus f square root of 8b over EA, and we're going to square that. And I should just do all this in one step. So if we square this, this is just going to be 8b squared, and I do like to do this term first. Plus 4 squared 8b squared e squared a squared. I don't even think this is how I did this problem, but now we try. This is a challenging way to do it. We already know e, we know a, and we know f, so I would just throw those in as just a solid number, but I guess we're doing it this way. All right, and then these two get multiplied, and we'll have two of those, plus two of whatever these multiplied. The 8s will become 8. The b squareds, we got an f, and then b squared divided by EA. Cool. All right, and now we're going to subtract. So that was this squared minus 2b squared, so we got 4b squared. All right. Oh, and if we look, hey, this is b squared, this is b squared, this is b squared, and this is b squared. So everything else is kind of a constant. So so we can factor out a b squared and then take the square root of everything, because we still got to take the square root of all this. And so once we do that, we're going to have a b squared square root, which just becomes b. And now we're going to have 8 plus f squared, or 8f squared over EA all squared, plus, this was 16f over EA minus 4. So if we have 8 minus 4, this is going to be 4. Cool. So there you go. So this would be the height final. And then the height initial was just 2b. So we have this is multiple of b minus 2b. So at the end of the day, we'd have b 4 plus 16f EA plus 8f squared e squared a squared minus 2. And there you go. That is going to be, and that's going to be the, this is going to be delta C. Delta C is that. And so let's throw this into our calculator. This one Probably get some more time on the clock. All right, heck yeah. And so this one, to find that force, is going to be the max stress times the area, which is 250. Now, it's in megapascals, but this is in millimeters. So you can just do 250 pi over 410 squared. And then, because this is 10 to the 6, but this, if you squared millimeters, you'd have to divide by 10 to the 6. And so that's kind of a quick trick. 250 times pi divided by 4 times 100. We're going to store that as, so each of these bars can take 19. So remember, it is crazy that I'm doing two problems at once, but we got 19,634 as our max force. So there you go. Our E, we're just assuming E for this is going to be 400 gigapascals. So that's going to be 400 times 10 to the 9. So I'm going to say alpha O, we're going to put 2. We don't need that anymore. But 400 times 10 to the 9, we're going to store that as alpha E. And then alpha F is our force. Alpha A is 10 divided at, alpha A is 10 squared times pi divided by 4 divided by 10 to the 6. Store that as our area. And now we're just good to go. So we're going to go 4 plus 16 times F divided by alpha E divided by alpha A plus 8 alpha F squared divided by alpha E squared divided by alpha A squared minus 2. Oh, and I guess 4 minus 2, we could have done that and just simplified that, but there you go. And we get delta C is equal to 2.01003 1 5 b, and initially this length, delta C is 2 b. I don't know, didn't that come out in the wash right there? Oh, that's interesting. I was off by a factor of 2, but I probably got the right answer in the end. Huh. And then, okay, so we're just going to minus 2b. And then so minus 2, and you'd get 0.0. Oh man, that was probably a bad way to do that one. All right, I'm going to take a pause on that. All right, heck yeah. So we're going to take a deep breath, and you know what I mean? That's why I wanted to make these videos, because let's say you do come across an error, you know what I mean? That's life, and you just have to move on. So we're going to solve this from a different direction. We know that the length of this, of these members, once they lengthen, that's going to provide that max change, and we're going to call that point C. And so let's throw all the numbers in. We won't solve it with just letters, but we have force is equal to sigma area. We already have that in our calculator, but we can do it one more time. 250 times pi over 4 times 10 squared. So 250 times 100 times pi divided by 4. And that's stored in our calculators, alpha F. That's that 19,634, 35 newtons. And so now this member, when it changes length, change in length will be FL over EA. And again, you know what I mean? Strength is force over area. Strain is change in length over length. And the relationship between strength and stretch is going to be EE. So you can put these three together to get, you can solve for change in length, you can solve for any of it, change in length, yeah. All right, so once we do that, then we have alpha F in there. Alpha L is going to be the square root of it, because we have 2b, so 2b squared, so that would be 4b squared plus 4b squared square root of that. That's going to be the square root of 8b squared, which is the square root of 8. So there you go. Length is square root of 8b. And then we have alpha e. For this one, we're going to go 400 times 10 to the 9, 400 gigapascals times the area is pi over 4. And then diameter 10 squared. But you do have to divide this by 10 to the 6 if you're doing it in millimeters. And I was just saying, it's like, whoa, it looks like this is F over A. So you could just do change in length is force over A, which is just sigma, which is your strength, length over E. So you could do it that way. And do 250 times 10 to the 6 divided by 400 times 10 to the 9 times change length is 0.8. Then you don't have to do that. And then 10 to the 9, 10 to the 6, so this is just 250 divided by 400,000 square root of 8. So, and then you should be able to do things. So let's do it both ways just to check any errors. So square root of 8 times alpha F divided by 400. Oh, sorry. Divided by 400 times, 10 to the 9 divided by pi divided by 4 divided by, divided by 10 to the 2 multiplied by 10 to the 6. So let's see if that's what we get here. Square root of 8 times 250 divided by 400,000. Heck yeah, same number. So our change in length, we're going to store that as x. We can get more time on the clock. All right, cool. So now we have, and then we forgot the b, you know what I mean? So we have this number. Change in length is 0.00176 times the length b. So if our length b is 1 meter, you know what I mean, our change in length is going to be 0.0017. And we know that for steel, our change in length, or our strain is 0.002. You know what I mean? So, and then that strain is equal to change in length divided by total length. So if our total length is 1, like 1 meter, our change in length, in this case, would be 0.002. Same thing for this one. If B is 1 meter, that means our change in length per a unit length of 1 meter is what this strain is called. So let's do that one more time. Strain is change in length divided by total length. Strain max for steel is 0.002, so the change in length for steel is, so you rearrange this, change in length is just strain times length, and there you go. So that's why I write these, because even though they're kind of unique, especially when it comes to strain and stretch, they're just equations, and each of these, you know, you can solve for anything. You can solve for length if you know strain. You can solve for change in length if you know the strain and the length. And just know that the strain is not just like, I call this strength, but it is stress. It's in PSI. If you don't put hardly any force in, you're not going to see hardly any PSI. And your PSI is not going to be anywhere near the breaking strength of steel, let's say, which is 250 megapascals. If you don't put any newtons in, then your newtons per meter is going to be really low. Same with your strain. Your strain max can be this 0.002. And for us, our strain max can be 0.00176. So yeah, we're in the ballpark. We know this is steel. And but, you know, it doesn't have... Your strain doesn't have to be. You can put less load, and your change in length is going to be less. So then your strain, strain is change in length divided by total length. Well, your total length doesn't change, but your change in length can be anywhere from zero to, you know, the max change in length. So right here we just solve. So again, to rearrange this equation, you'd say strain max is equal to change in length max. divided by L. I think doing these equations are going to help you way more in material mechanics, saying, hey, strength max is equal to force max divided by A. Because at the end of the day, sometimes you just want to know how much force you know, what is the breaking force? And then back it off by a factor of 2 or 4 or whatever. Okay, so now that we know our change in length, now we can do that relationship, Pythagorean's theorem. Right here we have 2B and 2B for our initial, and then our final, we're going to have still 2B right here, but this is going to be, this is the square root of 8B. So this is going to be the square root of 8B plus 0.00176B. Cool. And then we want to know what this height final is. And then at the end of the day, this change in C is just going to be height final minus 2B. So if we find height final, it's going to be very similar to what we got in our calculator, like 2.00 something. All right, so let's do that. So we would take this squared, so we'd go square root of 8 plus 0.00176, square that minus 2, and I guess this is b squared too, 2 squared b squared, and then the square root of that. So there you go. So we're going to square root of 8 plus square root of 8 plus x. Square that minus 2 squared, square root of that. So now we got 2.002499, and then the change in length would be 2 minus that. This minus 2, and we get 0.002499. Now, does that make sense? Yeah, because the change in length of this bar. Oh, shoot. Oh no, the length of this bar isn't just 1B, it's 2B. Oh, Toledo. But I think everything we did here was right. It's just that I was surprised that the strain is much lower for this. Well, let's just do a check on reality. So if that's where I was getting kind of confused, because this change in length though is a factor of B though. I don't think we don't lose that, because it's 2B minus the other B. So yeah, so it's change in length is still, because we still don't, you know, for this problem they don't tell you what that distance is. But would that make sense? That if this is the horizontal and the horizontal gets longer on both sides, that this, yeah, I guess I could see that. I don't really, but I mean we just did it right here, and so that's the only part that I kind of am not seeing geometrically. That if this bar gets longer, that just by a little bit, this bar gets longer. This distance gets changed by more than that change in length. So let's see. So if we had, let's say, because this sweeps down to here, that makes sense. Because anytime you have, anytime you can kind of do like a sweeping radius like that, and then so then once this bar is facing this point, hey, this distance right here is smaller than that distance. So if we have a small change in length there, we get a bigger one there. So there you go. I'm gonna say that's 100% right, and we did it. We did two problems, and yeah, I'll post this. Holy Toledo! But yeah, it's kind of interesting. I do like making videos where I've done the problem, but we're gonna just I know the problem enough where I can do it start to finish, and you know I'm gonna run into the same issues anyone else is gonna run into, so it might be a little bit seem crazy to even you know do stuff this way, but I think it's appreciative because the same problems that I get into you might. But yeah, these last two that I've posted have gotten definitely a little bit busier, and I'll definitely work on trying to make them not as busy. But anyway, hey, thanks for joining me, and guess what? That's a video.